Let's find out what the performance differences are between the new Nvidia RTX 2070 Super Max-Q and the older non-super version. Starting with the specs, the key difference is that the newer 2070 Super version has 11% more CUDA cores, but slightly lower base and boost clock speeds as a result. Both have an 80 to 115 watt power limit range. Basically, anything not 115 watts or max performance is considered max-Q, and both laptops I'm testing here run the GPU at 90 watts. The laptops I'm testing with are the Aero 17 from Gigabyte. The one from last gen has the Intel i9-9980HK CPU and Nvidia RTX 2070 Max-Q graphics, while the newer one has the Intel i7-10875H and new Nvidia RTX 2070 Super Max-Q graphics. Yes, there's a CPU difference, but it's quite subtle given they have the same core count, same cache, and boost similarly in this chassis. This is the closest I can do with what I had available. The 10th gen platform also offers higher memory speeds, which may affect some results too. But again, this is a legitimate difference that exists when comparing last gen with current gen. Super graphics will only be paired with 10th gen processors. Let's start out with games, then look at other 3D applications afterwards. Rainbow Six Siege was tested with the game's built-in benchmark tool. I've got the super results shown by the red bars, and the non-super results shown by the purple bars. In this test, the newest super laptop was 10.6% faster with ultra settings when compared against the older non-super laptop. Battlefield 5 was tested in campaign mode, running through the same section of the game on both laptops. In terms of average FPS, the 2070 Super was ahead in all cases, with a 10% lead at ultra settings. However, it was behind in terms of 1% lows. I've found 1% low performance inconsistent in this game, but this could also be due to our CPU difference. Shadow of the Tomb Raider was tested using the game's benchmark tool, and this game saw one of the largest differences out of all titles tested, with the newest Super GPU almost 19% faster in average frame rate at highest settings. CSGO was tested with the Uletical FPS benchmark, and with everything maxed out, the Super laptop was 27% faster than the older one, making this the biggest improvement out of all 13 games we're looking at here. Dota 2 was tested playing in the middle lane, and there was a much smaller difference here. 1% lows were either the same or went one way or the other slightly, while the averages were quite close too, with ultra settings just 3% faster from the Super laptop. The Division 2 was tested with the game's built-in benchmark, and there was less and less of a difference stepping up to the higher setting levels. At ultra settings, the Super laptop was just 3% faster than the older non-Super version. However, there was a larger 13% boost with the newer laptop at low settings. Granted, that's probably more likely to be the CPU and memory differences. Overwatch was tested in the practice range, as this allows me to perform the exact same test run. However, actual gameplay does perform a bit worse. At max settings, the Super laptop was 8% faster than the older one, though the 1% low differed much more at low settings. Assassin's Creed Odyssey was tested using the game's benchmark tool, and the Super laptop was 9% faster in terms of average FPS at the highest setting level here, with the same 1% low result from either. Metro Exodus was tested using the game's benchmark, and was another win in all cases for the Super laptop, which was 18.5% faster with the extreme setting preset. The Witcher 3 was tested in the same section of the game. However, the older laptop was actually slightly ahead at low to medium settings in average FPS. Granted, it was extremely close and negligible at the end of the day. At ultra settings where the GPU is presumably utilized more, the Super laptop was almost 4% faster. Far Cry New Dawn was tested with the game's benchmark, and the Super laptop was 9% faster in average FPS at ultra settings here, while the 1% low was much closer, at least at ultra. The gap seems to widen there at lower settings. Ghost Recon Wildlands was tested with the benchmark tool. I stopped testing this in favor of the newer Ghost Recon Breakpoint. However, that game launched after I did my 9th gen Aero 17 testing, so I've revisited it with the newest Super version. At ultra settings, the Super laptop was 12% faster, with nice improvements to 1% lows seen at all setting levels. Likewise, I've brought back Strange Brigade for the same reason. I needed to pad out some games, as a lot of the newer games I test these days weren't available when I tested the non-Super laptop. In this test, the Super laptop was 16.5% faster in average FPS at Ultra. These are the differences in performance when looking at all 13 games tested. On average, out of these titles, the 2070 Super Max-Q was 11.6% faster than the older 2070 Max-Q, at least when both have the same 90 watt power limit. While results can vary a fair bit between different titles, as you can see here, I found it interesting that this 11% average improvement basically matches the 11% increase to the CUDA core count that the Super version has over the older non-Super. Here's the difference we're looking at with 3D Mark. The Super laptop was 12% faster in terms of Firestrike graphics score, almost 10% faster for the TimeSpy graphics score, and then it reached a 14% higher score in the Port Royal test, which uses ray tracing. I've also run SpecView Perf 13, which is a benchmark for measuring graphics performance based on professional applications. In all cases, the 2070 Super laptop was ahead. However, the amount could vary a fair bit between specific tests. LuxMark is an OpenCL benchmark which renders out different scenes with the GPU. Depending on the test, the Super graphics performed 18 to 30% better in these tests. The V-Ray benchmark was also run on the GPU, and it renders out a scene as well. In this case, the Super laptop was scoring 20% higher in this task. So it looks like the GPU-specific rendering tests see further increased performance compared to most games. Both laptops have the same 94 watt hour battery, and interestingly, the new Super version lasted just a few minutes extra when compared to the older model while gaming, which may be down to some of the efficiency improvements Nvidia mentioned with these new GPUs. Unfortunately, I haven't got power draw and thermal data for GPU load, as I didn't test this with a non-Super Aero 17 when I had access to it. Again, all testing here was done with 90 watt power limits, so expect worse performance with 80 watt configurations, or likewise, more performance with a higher power limit. Unfortunately, the power limits aren't advertised with new laptops, so the only way to find out what power limits laptops run at is to watch reviews like mine. For updated pricing, you can check the links in the description. At the time of recording, I can't actually find the price of the 9980HK and 2070 Max-Q version of the Aero 17, but when I reviewed it late last year, it was around $3,200. Meanwhile, this new version, which is outperforming it in at least GPU tasks with the new Super graphics, is actually about $300 cheaper, so it seems more performance is available for less. Granted, I'm not too sure how the CPUs stack up. But from what I've seen so far, the i7-10875H isn't far behind the i9-9980HK. Obviously, if you already have a laptop with RTX 2070 Max-Q graphics, then it wouldn't be a good use of money to upgrade to 2070 Super Max-Q. But if you're buying today and the price gap is, say, a fair 10%, then the newer one does offer some improvement. And outside of games, this appears to be even higher with the Super GPU in 3D rendering applications. Let me know which of these GPUs you'd pick and why down in the comments. Otherwise, I look forward to reading all the Max-Q hate comments. Anyway, thanks for watching, and if you're new to the channel, consider getting subscribed for future laptop comparisons and tech videos like this one.